If someone asked you who your favorite film director is, how would you answer? Would you snap back immediately with a confident reply, or would you pause to go through a mental catalog? Answers may vary based on the generation to which you were born. Perhaps as a film person, you've found admirable traits in both old and new. If you were to name the single most emulated, consistent, yet versatile director in cinema history, what name would come to mind? Martin Scorsese, Stanley Kubrick, Francis Ford Coppola, John Ford? Any one of those could fit the bill in terms of their impact on culture, but none of them have quite the burgeoning and prosperous career of Steven Spielberg. For many children of the 70s and 80s, his particular brand of cinema is the reason for their passion in film. Just looking through his filmography was enough to inspire awe. His ability to manufacture iconic pop culture out of almost nothing is a skill that has placed him at the top of the Hollywood food chain for the last 3 to 4 decades.
Boy, I hate being right all the time.
If I were to break his movies into stylistic categories, I would describe them as 1. Commercial, 2. Art house, and 3. Historical. Although the last two can easily be lumped in with the first, I believe that at his core, Steven Spielberg makes movies not for any awards committee or film critic, but for human beings.
Let me get you to react to something that one of your peers said, another director. Steven Spielberg can't be compared with people like Mike Nichols or Barry Levinson. There is a place for mass entertainment, but it shouldn't be confused with art or quality award-winning filmmaking.
Sometimes I think that statements like that are pretentious in themselves, because it sort of says that, you know, art is serious and art can't move you. Art can't be on a bicycle with E.T. and fly across the moon. That can't be art, you know, that because it takes your heart along with it through the sky and it makes you feel like a kid again.
In a broad sense, this means that each of his films are curated and distributed specifically with us in mind. How is this different from any of the previous directors that you mentioned, you might ask? I'll get back to that in a minute. Spielberg's cinema is without a doubt some of the most recognizable in the past 50 years, but does that make it good? Of course not. What makes it truly excellent and worth studying is the inspiration, innovation, and technique behind nearly every scene. His blocking and picturesque backgrounds borrow heavily from John Ford, and his utilitarian approach to effects can be seen in his colleagues' works. Like any artist of any time period, his work is an amalgam of artists who came before, as well as his own voice. I don't think it would be a mistake to describe him as an auteur, but some would say that his cinema has become too grandiose and emotionally forceful to grant him the title. His gripping monologue scenes have become a trademark which some love and others hate.
Then that's my mission. You wanna leave? You wanna go off and fight the war? Alright. Alright, I won't stop you.
However, on the reverse side of this, we can find other less manipulative examples where the monologue fits organically and beautifully.
Standing there like that, you remind me of a man who used to come to our house when I was young. My father used to say, "Watch this man." So I did, every time he came. And never once did he do anything remarkable.
The standing man scene in 2015's Bridge of Spies is one of my favorite and most poignant monologues in recent history. This is due to a combination of things like the Coen brothers' writing, Thomas Newton's score, and Mark Rylance's flawless performance. But despite all of these elements, it takes a unique and delicate touch to assemble them into something so moving. The story informs us about Rudolf Abel's life while also reflecting back in a way that says something important about Donovan. His comments are simultaneously introspective and a projection onto the lawyer.
Stoiki muzhik. I remember them saying it. Deutsche Musik. That sort of means like standing man. Standing man.
Going back to the question from earlier, I would say that the main distinction between the work of Steven Spielberg and that of his peers is his ability to drive straight to the human heart. He does so with all of the methods mentioned in this video, but also with archetypes. The 12 Jungian archetypes are defined as an innate tendency to generate images with intense emotional meaning that express the relational primacy of human life. These are the underlying, deepest type of models in human history, and we see their form shining through in both secular and religious films. They emerge from a part of the psyche that yearns for meaning and for stories to digest that meaning. More than any other director I have seen, Spielberg has a way of bringing these unconscious archetypes to life as players on a screen. Whether it's the ruler, the explorer, or the rebel, his knack for portraying them tragically and poetically is rarely paralleled. To answer the question from the opening of this video, I would reply by saying that I don't really have a favorite director. There are many that I admire, some that I have explored in depth on this channel, and others I have yet to, but as with all things, there are perfections and imperfections. My sense is that every director, no, every man in this world, has the ability to tell his story, to muster up some inner part of himself that speaks to the conscience and to the soul. It is easier to some than others, but I see evidence that the ability is, in fact, innate in each of us. Some may speak the story around a campfire, while others may compose it in writing or song. But the fact of the matter is that we hunger for it, like food. It gives us life sustenance and a reason to carry on.